happy holidays. It's BJ enjoying a wonderful winter wonderland. Hope you enjoy the show this year. Whoa!
My name is Martiqua. Thank you for joining us today. First, I'd like to wish you a very wonderful holiday. I hope that you're enjoying family and friends and loved ones. Thank you for tuning in to share your holiday with us. Today, we're going to be discussing the aspects of Christmas that many of you may not realize have connections to the pagan or neo-pagan community. Some of the very basic things that you focus on when you think of Christmas often have pagan connections to them, and we're going to be discussing some of those today. Now, that may be a little uncomfortable for some of you. It may be very unusual, and that's understandable, which is one of the reasons why I happen to think it's important that we share it with you a little bit and give you a better understanding of how a different spiritual belief system has been influenced by the one that many of you may have, and how yours has been influenced by many other different ones as well. It's good to be aware of that. It makes communication far easier, and you are much more informed that way. So today, what we're going to start with, I think, is we're going to talk about some of the very basic things that you recognize when you think of Christmas, and we're going to talk about how those things are connected to paganism. One of the terms that is most frequently used with paganism or neo-paganism, modern paganism, is the term Yule. And I believe it is a Norwegian term, and it takes place, the celebration of Yule itself takes place on the winter solstice on or around December 21st, at least in the Northern Hemisphere. And that is why we often choose this holiday season to talk about the aspects of Yule and the rituals and the symbolism that's associated with it. The year or the calendar that pagans follow often, and there's a wide variety of pagan beliefs, so the information that I'm sharing with you is not concrete or cast in stone, as there will be various differences depending on which pagan philosophy you're following, but in general, the calendar, the year, is considered a repeating cycle that you use to structure the ritual and the activity that you engage in. Just as you have specific holidays in December or in January or in February, so does the pagan community. And in the month of December and the month of January, this is when Yule and other similar holidays like Twelfth Night and various other things are celebrated. The cycle is a cycle of birth, death, and renewal. And it follows often the natural cycle of the holidays, the seasons changing. And as the seasons change and you note that and celebrate that and plan for that, there are holidays and observances and rituals that are attached to those things. Therefore, the the cycle of the year, or the calendar of the year, is referred to as the wheel of the year, because it's an ever-repeating system that you follow. So Yule, or midwinter, which is another name for it, is viewed as a time of introspection and planning for the future, where rituals guarantee the continuity of nature's cycles. And so, as adherents to that belief system, we take part in those rituals to show how we recognize our connection to the natural cycles of the planet we're living on. And as a result of that, solstice rites and rituals actually have a very, very long history. They are, in fact, some of our oldest celebrations, and they date back to even as far back as the dawn of modern civilization, some 30,000 years ago. So some of these rites and activities have existed in one form or another since that long ago. And it's important to note that, because though things change over time with new influences and new experiences, we tend to try to keep them essentially the same. And knowing that you have that long of a history supporting what you do certainly helps you to believe that you are connected to the natural cycle of the world. The Celts and or Druids referred to this time, this period of the year, this season of the year, as the death of the old sun and the birth of the dark half of the year. That is why we often center our activities around our home. We become introspective, we pull in, we do more activities inside instead of outside because of the weather. And the Druids especially referred to this as the dark half of the year, calling it Alban Athuan, because it was a time when the harvest was finished. There was no longer any outdoor activity that needed to be done on a regular basis, a routine or a cycle that had to be followed. Everything was now taken indoors, and all of your thought and planning and preparation was internal and psychological, as opposed to external and outside, because of the weather and because of the cycles in nature. The Roman Emperor Aurelian blended several pagan solstice rites with various different celebrations of nativity, calling the resulting event the birth of the unconquered sun, or Sol Invictus. And this is a very primary event that was used as the basis for many of the pagan rituals and celebrations, that format of Sol Invictus. It very strongly informed what pagans and neo-pagans do in their rituals now during the solstice or Yule season. Christians celebrate Christmas in this season also, and as has happened with many other pagan rites and celebrations, Yule and many of its symbolism was deemed necessary to Christianize it, make it acceptable for the prominent religious observance and the prominent religious faith, which was Christianity. And as a result of Christianizing pagan events and pagan dates and pagan locations, we have what is now called Christmas. Let me clarify that statement. I do not want to leave our audience with the impression that I am implying that Christmas or Christianity exists solely because paganism was there first. That is, in fact, not how I personally believe, but there are some who do, frankly, and that is why many turned from Christianity, because of the things that were done in the name of Christianity to pagans and those who believed other than what was the accepted form and what you were expected to believe. Now, some of the pagan symbols that had to be made more acceptable, more Christian, happened to be the evergreen tree, which symbolizes, at least in pagan belief systems, the eternal presence of the goddess, because it does not lose its leaves in the cold season. It maintains them, and it stays green when most other growth does not. And so it was viewed as a symbol of the eternal presence of the goddess, even at the darkest time of the year. Santa Claus, or Saint Nicholas, is a representation of the horned god, or a being referred to as Old Nick in many of the pagan belief systems. Often, Old Nick has been subverted into an image of the devil and Satan worship and that kind of thing. Though there may in fact be individuals who worship Old Nick in that way, I don't know. Many of the neo-pagans, in fact, do not worship according to the stereotypes that you see when someone speaks of paganism. It's actually very different from those in the East. And God send you a happy new year. To all your kids, hope that we're the following year. We wish you a Merry Christmas and a Happy New Year. Love and joy. Holly, ivy, and mistletoe were images or symbols for luck and fertility, used as talismans for the coming year. Ivy to demonstrate the female, and holly to demonstrate the male. Used to decorate the home, to ward against negative energy, evil spirits, if you will. Often these symbolisms, these images, these talismans, ivy, mistletoe, and so forth, were used to consecrate a space for the season, the colder season, the introspective season, to bring the sacred back indoors so that rituals could take place indoors when the weather did not as easily allow for it to happen outdoors. And so those talismans were put up to ward the space, to protect the space, to prepare the space, to assure its sacredness. The Yule log, which you may see burning behind me here, was often crafted from oak, ash, birch, or yew, and the typical routine or ritual associated with the burning of the Yule log is that each year when you burn it, you retain a small piece of that wood, and then the following season, the following Yule season, you use that piece to light the new Yule log. Again, to represent the continuation of the wheel of the year, the cycles of nature. Also, the Yule log was also referred to often as the sacred tree, because Celts and Druids used pieces from these trees in sacred events to celebrate special occasions. And so they would always assure that they had pieces of this wood available even during that season when they might not be able to get a piece of it. Otherwise, they would hold on to it in advance so that they would have it to use for those special events and use for those rites. They were considered items of power and items of sacredness and a vessel for the gathering of energy and the sending out of intent, which is something that happens when you engage in a ritual. You want the energy of your intent to go out into the universe. And they believed that having sacred objects to do that would enhance that strength. And so they believed that wood, like birch and yew and others were those sacred items. Other various things that now represent Christmas for most people and began representing pagan belief systems are things like the color combination of red, green, and gold, because each one of those colors illustrates or represents a different thing. The green being plant growth, the gold being the return of the sun, even in the darkest time of the year. And if I can undo this, the red representing the blood, the lifeblood in our system that continues to flow even when the dark time of the year has approached and other growth does not allow itself to be visible. Other things like hanging ornaments upon a tree, much as we do with Christmas celebrations, eating lots of sweets, processions of one type or another, often reflected aspects of the pagan rituals that were enacted, gift giving, wassailing or singing carols, often wassailing itself took place in apple orchards, and there was a process for awakening the trees in the dark and frozen time of the year to begin the wassailing process, and people would march through the orchard with small sticks in their hands, and they would beat the trunks of the trees and yell and scream to awaken the trees again during that frozen time. And they would harvest the apples and use the apples themselves and the cider that was created from them, whether it be alcoholic or non-alcoholic, as part of the wassailing process. They would carry it with them from location to location as they sang in groups for their friends and their families and their loved ones to bring the light back to the frozen season. They would carry torches with them, or they would carry lanterns with them or candles with them as they wassailed their families and friends. And it was a way of assuring that small villages and small tribes kept close-knit and kept in touch with each other, even at the coldest times of the year when it might be harder to get out and connect with other people. That was a way of doing that, in order to make sure that everyone was still okay, that there was contact between them, that they were healthy. Some of the things I referred earlier to, hanging ornaments upon a tree. Nowadays, for Christmas, we hang ornaments representing many things on our Christmas trees, and often there is such a wide variety of things you can choose from to decorate your Christmas tree with that it has become, well, in my opinion only, very commercial. There's all sorts of niche markets for ornaments that you can get. Well, originally, trees were decorated with fruits, nuts, berries, popcorn, even flowers. Whether they were kept from the spring season and dried, or whether they were sealed in resin so that they could be kept intact before they were put onto the tree for the season. Hanging those ornaments was viewed as a symbolic act designed to bring about the return of summer's bounty. Because an evergreen tree, again, the the continuing and permanent evidence of the goddess's presence, covered with natural things that grew as part of nature, fruits, nuts, berries, popcorn, flowers, left an impression of nature's bounty, which is exactly what you were symbolizing. You were reminding everyone around you that though this may be a frozen and barren time, bounty will again return because of the ever-continuing presence of the goddess and her bounty. As we finish up this session, I would like again to thank you for joining us and ask you to return again in the future, because in our next segment we're going to focus more directly on Yule and the winter solstice and some of the aspects associated with that. And as we go out now, and I thank you again for your time, have a joyous holiday, please. Make it the best you can and celebrate your family and those you love. And as we leave, we will be sharing with you a very traditional Christmas song which has a very strong pagan connection, and that is Here We Go A-Wassailin'. Bye now, and thank you so much for joining us. Have a wonderful holiday.
Here we come a-wassailin',
here we come a-wassailin', upon the lee so green. Here we come a-wandering, so fair to be seen. Love and joy come to you, and to you your wassail too. And God bless you and send you a happy new year. And God send you a happy new year. A wassail cup is made of the rosemary tree. And so is your beer of the best barley. Love and joy come to you, and to you your wassail too. And God bless you and send you a happy new year. And God send you a happy new year.